My name is Chase Klitsky, and I'm a master trainer, master instructor. While employed with the Department of Defense, I was responsible for designing specialized programs and the supervision of their completion that basically advanced force readiness. This was accomplished by understanding the mental and physical demands of our active duty, the special forces units, and the civilian anti-terrorist training personnel. As a ufologist since 1994, I've brought a lot of that training and tactical mindset with me to bring into my investigations. I was responsible and led a national rapid response unit that only responded to the most complicated and sensitive UFO cases reported in the nation. This, of course, was done with only the most expert and experienced investigators in the field. I believe investigating UFOs is really important because to find the truth behind advanced, intelligent, extraterrestrial, biological entities, it changes everything. It changes everything. I also believe that it's going to be all the information we're going to need of the past and also the future. It's not just about finding UFOs, it's also about the journey. Every time we step out of our box, every time we step out of our elements, we advance as a society, we advance as a species. We thought the world was flat, we looked out to the horizon, and then we decided to go ahead and take a look. The journey to do that created all sorts of new technologies and engineering and things that people could use every day. We wanted to go to the moon, and just the journey and the planning and the execution of that task to get into space and to hit this has afforded us common household goods and things we use every single day. So it isn't just the big picture of are aliens really real. It isn't just the whole aspect of abductions and what do they want. It's also the journey that provides us as a species advancements in everything. Of course, to find out that there's extraterrestrial existence somewhere else absolutely changes life as we know it.
Hey guys. Hey, thanks for coming. I know it's really short notice and everything. And we do have a case that came in, and I know it's Sunday, but this is kind of a priority. We've had reports coming in from Moorhead, Kentucky for probably about 3 weeks now, and there's things are starting to speed up. So I made a few phone calls, and we contacted the park rangers because it's right here. We're real close on the Daniel Boone National Forest. So contacting them, even the park ranger at the ranger station admitted that he was getting reports and people were contacting them as well about these strange lights. What they've done is reporting these lights in the sky in this area over here. They tell me that they're coming in through the tree lines and they're not very high. So these aren't like high lights in the sky. They're actually penetrating the canopy of the tree lines, maneuvering intelligently and then ascending back up. Now what I like about this case is because it's right here next to Cave Run Lake. They say there's a humming noise that comes through the lake as well. So this is something that I really want to prioritize on. So logistically, what I'd like to do is set up a base camp up on that ridge. The ridge is probably about 20 to 30 foot high, which also means we're going to need rope gear. We're going to get our equipment up here. We're going to set up a perimeter so we can keep a surveillance on that tree line where those lights are most reported. I am going to put a boat in, and we're going to patrol very slowly on the other side, giving us a different angle to that area of interest. Sound good, guys? Okay, so what do we need? We're going to need camera set up, so we're going to need our DVRs. We're going to need these cameras. But because the reports of the lights are kind of low, they're anywhere between 4 feet off the ground and, of course, ascending straight up through the trees, I want to check if there's any magnetic type fluctuations that are commonly reported in UFOs. So we want our mag pods, we want our night vision, we want our IR cameras, and I'm also going to take a parabolic dish and I'm going to set up with a computer in the boat, trying to capture that humming noise. I want to capture it live, and I want to be able to broadcast to you guys as well. So that's going to be a new step that we're going to be experimenting with as well. So I'm on one end patrolling the waters, you guys are on the other end. One of the interesting things I also found in this area, NASA built a telescope in the middle of the woods in Kentucky. It's a major telescope, and what they're telling me is that it's actually coming from the university, which is way up on that area over there, and they have like this big program, but this telescope is advancing and experimenting with advanced RF technologies. I'm interested in that. I think that's a big deal. It's a really big deal. I want to know more about that. Apparently, it's a 21-meter class antenna, which is a medium-sized telescope, and it's engaged in rigorous research programs in radio astronomy. What does that mean, radio astronomy? It means they're not just looking, they're also advancing some of these signals. It's insane. I love it. But I also found very interesting that the Morehead State University and Kentucky Space Program, still funny, have partnered with Radiance Technologies, i3, Tethers Unlimited, and Honeywell. It's a pretty bizarre mix of partnerships for a university that claims that they're just looking into studies and astronomy. So I think it's very interesting. So we make a rapid deployment. We get out there today. I'm going to go ahead, like I said, we're going to load that boat. I'm going to patrol the perimeter. You guys will be setting up base camp. Peter, I'm going to need you at the helm. I'm going to have you and Pete walking through as well. We're going to set up that perimeter. Any questions?
So you really think the government knows about UFOs?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Historically, we have documentation of that, truthfully. When you think about, well, take for example, in 1974, they amended the Freedom of Information Act. The 70s was huge in ufology. We captured so much. Sightings were up, reports were up. We're getting so many different things, and it was an explosion all over the world, the entire 70s as a decade. But because they amended the Freedom of Information, we also were able to gather tons and tons of documents. There was an executive order issued in 1982 that kind of halted a lot of our work with that. And of course, as time has gone on and the Patriot Act, our getting these documents is less and less frequent. It's really ridiculous. A lot of these come out, they're blacked out, which looks really cool, but they still have given us a lot of information. For example, we have in 1947, we have a Twining memo. In 1949, we have an FBI memo. Oh my gosh, guys, so we have the United States Air Force Intelligence Report. Now let's jump ahead, let's talk about 1975. We have Wordsmith Air Force Base memos. 1976, we have the Tehran UFO incident. We have incursions everywhere. We also have, let's jump ahead, 1981, we have the Holt memo. Let's just jump ahead. We have 1988. What do we have at this point? We have the United States Coast Guard UFO encounter. This is all documented, guys. This is all information we've received from Freedom of Information. 1989 to 1990, Belgium Triangle incidents. They're all over the world, guys. We have a clear history from 1947, which we know is the banner year for ufologists because that's the year of the Roswell crash. That's what started the grassroots civilian force. No joke, we're going to look for ourselves. You know, we want this information. We're curious as to what's going on, and we're not getting the information from the government. And that's why we get to do what we do today. These guys started everything. So there's a clear history. I mean, we've got documentations all the way up to present day. Like I said, they're more difficult now than they used to be, but we keep trying. We keep snipping at the heels. We keep knocking on the doors and asking for information. Even President Obama has put out a new policy, which is petitions. So we had people sign petitions. We ask them to answer. The Department of Science and Technology at the White House is usually who gives us back that information. But truthfully, it was really nothing. Did we expect President Obama to give disclosure with these? Absolutely not. We do better. But we're using political expertise, prowess, and we're also using the government's own policies to further our quest for this information. It's just awesome. Nipping at the heels. Kind of keeps them honest. Ooh, that's probably a little less common than extraterrestrials, honest politicians, but there we go. Okay, guys, so we ready? Everybody set? We know where base camp's going to be. We know the equipment that we're going to have. We know the strategic plan. Guys, have any questions? All right, let's fire all cylinders and pack up the equipment. There you go. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to set up some sound equipment. I just uploaded a new program that's also going to give us a visual audio graph. So that will help us with ambient sound while we're out in the water. And we get anything and we'll be able to see it. And I'll be able to record it live and also broadcast it back to the base camp.